anxious to hear from one of God's pastors here, and he's going to tell us about something about God that we want to hear. And listen up. This is from the Kingdom of God series. The sermon's going to be called The Return of the King.
Hello. How is everybody today? A good Sabbath day, isn't it? We're here. We have challenges in life. We don't always get to just leave them at the door, but we are here together, fellowshipping together, and hopefully learning and learning from God and what He wants us to understand. I'm hopeful that what I have for you today is from God and that He wants us to understand. And hopefully you will understand. There are sixes and sevens because at about 8:45 this morning, I was like, I wonder who else is taking part in services today. Because I didn't have anything to do. And that's when I realized that I have a sermon. So I'm feeling a little less organized than I normally would. The title of my message, obviously, is continuing in this series that I've been doing on the Kingdom of God. Maybe I'm jumping to the end, because we want the return of the King. Yeah. We really want the return of the King. But for some of you, when we say the phrase, the return of the King, what comes to mind? Lord of the Rings. There you go. Brian actually beat Joseph. See that. Who's watched Lord of the Rings? And now you're hearing the theme. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Right? It's going in your head, right? And you're thinking about, what's the name of the king? Aragorn? Aragorn? Something like that. I'm a Narnian fan myself, so I do enjoy the Lord of the Rings, and of course Tolkien and Lewis were pretty good buddies. And I like to think that we are saving some formulas in the storyline. The Lord of the Rings. So in our house, as you may guess, Joseph is a voracious reader, and he's been just demolishing everything Lord of the Rings recently. Three books, and then two other additional stories, and then maybe The Hobbit. All of that together, right? Four books. Okay. And I think he listens to them in the space of 8 hours or something. And he just goes through them. But there's something else that goes along with the story. The last song. Did you guys know the song? Do you guys know the song of Durin? We do in our house. Because when a certain young man has been given the task that he's struggling to really get through, like doing the dishes or some other chore around the house, he plays the song. I'm going to play a little bit of it for you. It sounds like Gregorian chant here at a house with all of these songs while he's doing the dishes. That's just a little fun. The return of the king, while the end result is fun, but the process is not that fun. We're going to look a little bit at some scriptures today that are not really, we're not positive for a certain group of people. And they're challenging to read. It's a little bit of prophecy. We're not going to get really deep into the prophecy, but I wanted to just be thinking about and setting the stage in our mind for the return of the king. And there's some really important attributes that we need to look for. As we are looking toward the end of the age, this may come maybe here, it may be about to start, it may be in 5,000 years. I don't know. But I kind of feel like it's around the corner. And we maybe feel that way because we've seen some of the characteristics, some of the things that we read in Scripture happening around this corner. And so I just thought it's really important to identify some things that we can take to heart, keep in our mind, keep in our heart, remember that when the end of the age comes, we're not defeated. Right? Now, there's certainly a lot of research that you can do. You can go into the prophecies, you can connect them and make charts and timelines. Lots of people find that really interesting to do, and that's their part. But some of the most simple elements that will keep us on the straight and narrow, keep us understanding where we are in time and where we are in our relationship with God, are actually really not to do with prophecy at all. They're to do with our relationship with the King. So it's very important that we keep that in mind. So the idea of the return of the King is biblical. But it's also throughout culture, isn't it? It's throughout mythology. It's throughout, you know, the modern mythologies that we have, from Lord of the Rings, Chronicles of Narnia, you know, that's my favorite, Aslan, the king, the rightful king, returning and liberating the country of Narnia. And then we have, all the way back in mythology, another one that Mark and I are familiar with, is King Arthur, right? And the Knights of the Round Table. You and I were both one of those knights for one time. Okay. Maybe not. Maybe when we were boys acting like the story. But even in that story, King Arthur, right, there's a line in the narrative, in the mythology that says, when Britain needs him the most, King Arthur will return. Right? So the tale of the king is this monumental moment that changes everything. And that's what we are looking for. When Aslan, or Arthur, or Aragorn, or whatever his name is, Aragorn, okay, when he puts the world to right, right, when he defeats the enemy and puts it to right. And I love the story in C.S. Lewis. I don't know if you remember in the Chronicles of Narnia, the lion that was in the wardrobe, the beaver, right, is tallying the Pevensey, yes, that Aslan is afoot. He's around. He's returning. And he's building his army. And they're like magically mystified by the story, but they don't know who Aslan is. And he defeats the tiger. This king has returned. And in the story of Narnia, he's this lion. And Aslan, in I think Turkish, means lion. And so C.S. Lewis is, you know, this is the lion's lion. This is the king of beasts. This is the king of kings. And of course, the whole storyline of Narnia, you get to. I want to show the Dawn Feather, which is fourth book, I think, finally reveals to the children why he revealed himself to them in the first place, in the story of Narnia. The story that they get to learn his name here in the real world. And Lewis, of course, is embedding within the storyline the Christian, the gospel, the truth of Jesus is our king. I just love that story. So we have all of these stories. We have all these myths. And they all have a taste, a promise, a kind of a hint of the true king that we're looking to return and set the world right. So what is he setting right? Because if something needs to be set right, then we're always. Well, we're in a place that's wrong, right? We're in a place that is not the way it's supposed to be. And we can tell this world is not the way it's supposed to be. And more we see that it's not the place that we're supposed to be. That we're trapped under the oppression of the enemy, the white witch, or Mordor, right? Dark Lord, or all of those imagery, and it kind of makes sense. And we know this battle, we're familiar with it. And that's why these stories are so powerful for us. So the world itself is trapped. Pretending to the throne. Right? There's somebody that wants the throne, but they are not the real king. We're looking for the real king, for the king of the king. So we're ready. We're ready for that story to conclude, and for that enemy to be taken down, and for the king to take up his reins and rule. But of course, the only place we can really understand any of these myths, old or new, is in Scripture, is in the Word of God. Because that's where all of these things come from. And in this book, we're given a glimpse. Not a lot of detail when you really think about it. It's some amazing prophecies and some fanciful creatures and this lots of interaction. And it doesn't really tell us specifics about what's going to happen. Hence, all the charts get created and the timelines, and people analyze it and try and understand. But there are, as I said earlier, some very important things we can take personally to prepare us as we glimpse into the prophecies of the return of the king. So, I thought it might be useful today for us to remind ourselves what we're looking for and why we are looking for these things, So when you think about Jesus returning and establishing the kingdom of God, what are the first scriptures to come in? The sky opening up. What? Why are you in a white horse? So what scripture comes to mind? It's Revelation. Revelation is Revelation 18 and 19 on into 20. And so we're going to jump into these chapters here because to me, lots of times, I mean, there's a total steal from the book of Revelation in one of the Lord of the Rings movies where, you know, Gandalf the White now is leading this army, and he's kind of coming down this steep mountainside on a white horse, and the sunlight or whatever is behind him, and it's just glorified, and it's almost like he's coming out of the sky. Totally, totally takes it from Revelation, okay? That's what we see here. And so we're going to jump into these passages here, and it's going to feel a little jarring because we're jumping into almost like a split screen of the story, taking us rapidly to the conclusion of the end of the age and the end of man's reign on the earth and the return of the rightful king. So, firstly, let's set the stage a little bit. In Revelation chapter 17, verse 15, we are presented with a powerful city, a great, powerful city that is holding sway over the whole earth. In verse 15 it says, "And then he said to me, the waters that you saw where the harlot sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. And the 10 horns that you saw on the beast, these will hate the harlot and make her desolate and naked, eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God has put it into their hearts to fulfill his purpose to be of one mind and to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled." Another thing to, the first thing to probably remember as we read all of this imagery, this upsetting imagery really, is that God is in control of all these pieces. He has put these pieces in play, and he's playing them out. He is in control already, before he even returns. And the woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. Think about great cities of history. Certain cities come to mind. You saw a lot of cities that come to mind. Great, powerful cities in history. Rome, London, New York. What else? Washington. I mean, there's some really powerful cities in history, right? What makes them happy? Well, they dominated the region that they were in. You know, they either dominated the country, dominated the entire region beyond country borders, and some cities, like Rome, what do we call Rome? The Eternal City. Called the Eternal City. I mean, talk about that city. But that's how it seemed, right? Rome, and of course, with the Catholic Church and the Holy See and this Eternal City. And yet, it has had a powerful history. It has shaped an entire set of nations of which we are a part. Rome's tradition and impact in the world is alive today in our language, in our culture, in our architecture, in everything. It changed the face of the world, the face of the world. And there's other cities. The original Babylon was one of those cities, wasn't it? A powerful city. Unbelievable wealth for its time, and it influenced and shaped the region and the culture. And of course, London, as you may mention, sat at the top of the largest empire in world history, and is the reason that we're all speaking English, and that so many people around the world speak English as a first or second language. Powerful city that has this overwhelming influence. Washington, D.C., New York City, the center of trade and political power in the earth today. You know, and unfortunately, other influences too, right? And that's the point. That is what we're supposed to learn from this. Because powerful cities influence for good, and they influence for bad, unfortunately. And so we do. We have these cities in history, and so it's important to think about Babylon being one of these cities. It's not the dusty remains of ancient Babylon. It's not even ancient Babylon of its type that was, by comparison to other empires, a relatively small region. This is the Babylon that sits on top of all the people and nations and seas of the world. This is that great city. So, in Revelation chapter 18, verse 1, it says, after these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the Great is fallen, and has become the dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out from her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plague. For her sins have reached the heaven, and God has remembered her iniquity. Render to her just as she rendered to you, and repay her double according to her works in the cup which she has mixed double for her. In the measure that she has glorified herself and lived luxuriously, in the same measure did her torment and sorrow. For she says in her heart, I sit as a queen. I am no widow. I will not see sorrow. Therefore, her plagues will come in one day. Death and mourning and famine, and she will be utterly burned with fire. The throne is the Lord God. He judges. There is a lot in this passage, right? And it's so hard in many ways to think of a city being so dominant and so powerful. And yet, as we just discussed, there's been so many cities that have. At its height, London, the London economic system, right? The British Empire, controlled 70% of the world's trade directly, and 30%. Indirectly. It just controlled it all. And if you wanted to trade, the central place to trade was through that London Stock Exchange, through that whole financial system. And where is it now? It's a little bit in London, it's a little bit in Berlin, it's a little bit in Paris, but we said it earlier, today it's New York City. It still remains that way. And then the political power down the road in Washington, D.C. These are powerful cities, and they do control global economics and trade. All the interactions with merchants. Has there ever been a time when we've had the kind of wealth that we see in individuals today? Think about some of the super rich people. Maybe. There's a time when we used to say Bill Gates is the richest man on earth, right? He's still pretty rich. But then, Bezos, but even before that, the other Soto guy, I forget his name, good friend with Bill Gates. Suffered for his time. Bezos, now, Elon Musk. This kind of wealth is astronomical. And that's not even including all the small guys that only have a few billion dollars to play. Right? And you think about that level of wealth, I don't know if there's been a time in which we've experienced that level of wealth by so few individuals. Maybe an argument can be made in the 1900s, early 1900s, and the period of the robber barons and that wealth started as well. But we're talking about globally powerful individuals that have so much money they can literally affect the change, whatever they want in the world. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation dumped billions of dollars into third world countries and all kinds of programs, and they're accountable to themselves. You know that. And they've actually done some significant damage in parts of the world. So Babylon gives rise to all this wealth to these merchants, and the goal is to maintain that wealth, to maintain those trading agreements and alliances and partnerships. And yet in the middle of all this, Babylon has become a cesspool. To quote Obi-Wan Kenobi, right? You never will find a more wretched pile of scum and villainy. Right? This is that city. And where devils inhabit. I mean, is this where Tolkien got his ideas of awe? I mean, just, every foul creature and bird coming out of the ground almost in this city. This city, this end-time Babylon, is filled with wickedness. Every evil and distortion known to man. Do you sometimes think we might be living in that place? And we've seen some of the things that are happening in our community, and certainly we get a magnifying glass through the media on different issues and different approaches. And everybody makes money by making us read all of this and get riled up about these issues and topics. But they are really taking place in our community. Some of these things, I think, are very active and alive in our community. And we can see the rise, we're witnessing the increase of Babylonian-type things all around us. And we shouldn't be surprised, because the scripture I just read here, in verse 4, it sounds so strange, because how is this happening? So we have this terrible city filled with all this crime, this wealth, and everything that is against God, and yet there are God's people living within this city. How does that happen? How does a city that is so evil still contain God's people that he's given a warning to come out lest you be partakers of this thing? How does that happen? Why do we see that today? Have we changed? Has our values about what's right and what's wrong changed? I don't feel like that's changed. Marriage to me is still between one man and one woman. Right? We didn't change. That's been the way it's been for human civilization. Last 5 minutes, it's now this other thing. Pick whatever you want, I guess. We didn't change. But society is changing around us. And it's really interesting because this isn't the first time that it's happened. As we'll see, there's another city. Another city that was good and then became a Babylon. And it's interesting. There's always been a prophetic element to this idea that Babylon is fallen twice, right? Babylon is a fallen, fallen city. And I'm wondering if that's also to do with its maybe more moral condition and then falling into sin and then falling into God's judgment when the king returns. But think about our experience. I can't remember what it was. We were talking about it. Something in the news that I read. It reminded me not long after I had moved to the States. I remember there being a big news story in Texas, eliminating the laws on sodomy. So this is back in the 1997, let's say, and it was long that time. And it hadn't been enforced for a while, anyway, right? And you know what sodomy was, right? And it's basically outlawing homosexuality. Well, so they got rid of that. You know, just let people do whatever they want in the privacy of their own homes. Let's not make all these people criminals. You know, they want to just love one another, and it's none of our business. Live and let live. Or where are we to go? It starts the process, doesn't it? It starts to unravel the morals of society. And we've seen this in our own experience, and we saw it in the nation of Israel. In the holy city, in Jerusalem, where the temple of God was, where they had the law of God given to them, where God was present in the temple, and yet they went this way. In Isaiah chapter 1, the first chapter of Isaiah, the first message that Isaiah is giving to the people, he says in verse 21, how the faithful city has become a harlot. It was full of justice. It was full of justice. It wasn't perfect, but God is saying it was full of justice. Righteousness lodged in it. Righteousness lived there. It was like a residence. It was part of the fabric of the city.
But now, murderers. Your silver has become bronze. Your wine mixed with water. Your princes are rebellious and companions of thieves. And everyone loves the bribe and follows after the reward. They do not defend the fatherless, nor does the cause of the widow come before them. So we have quite the opposite, right? We have this faithful city, and now its town is fallen, and it's become the opposite. And we have the opposite in society today. We have children being preyed on by deliberate forces to destroy their bodies, to destroy any future life and potential that they have for relationships in the way in which God designed them to be. How did we get in 1998 and removing the sodomy laws to this? How did we get here? Changes over time, right? Changing in morality and decision. And what's the outcome? Destruction of the innocent. Attacking these innocent lives. Undermining life itself. Conspiring together to do this to the innocent. Therefore, the Lord says, the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, I will rid myself of my adversaries and take vengeance on my enemies. I will turn my hand against you and thoroughly purge away your dross and take away all your alloy. I will restore your judges at the first and your counselors at the beginning. Afterward, you shall be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city. Very different faith for Jerusalem. A very different faith for Jerusalem from Babylon. God remembers his graciousness. He remembers his promise. He remembers his love for that city. But he still brings his judgment. He still brings justice. Zion shall be redeemed with justice, and her penitence with righteousness. The destruction of transgressors and of sinners shall be together, and those who forsake the Lord shall be consumed. For they shall be ashamed of the terebinth trees which he has desired. They shall be embarrassed because of the gardens which he has chosen. The places that they worship are against God, the practices that they engage in. The youth shall be as a terebinth tree whose root fades, and as a garden that has no water. The strong shall be a tinder, and the work of it as a spark. Both will burn together, and no one shall quench them. Zion will be redeemed. Jerusalem will be redeemed by God's grace. But you can see they kind of deserve the same fate as Babylon, don't they? That God is going to be specific and purge out of that city, purge out all that death, and leave it perfect, bring it back to being perfect. Babylon will not have that. Babylon's faith is complete. If we go back to Revelation chapter 18 and verse 9, the kings of the earth who committed fornication, lived luxuriously with her, will weep and lament for her when they see the smoke of her burning. Standing at a distance, because they don't want to get involved. They don't want to swoop in and try and rescue this city. They don't want to try and save it, because they know the power that is bringing this judgment on this city.
But alas, alas, the great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour your judgment has come, and the merchants of the earth will weep and mourn over her. Why are they weeping and mourning? What they lost. I mean, the selfishness and the self-centeredness, everything about this is all about their own personal wealth and gain. They didn't even love this city. They just loved what it gave them. Utterly corrupt, aren't they? These merchants. So no one buys their merchandise anymore. Merchandise of gold and silver, precious stones and pearls, fine linen and purple, silk and scarlet, and every kind of citron wood, and every kind of object of ivory, every kind of object of most precious wood and bronze and iron and marble, and cinnamon and incense and fragrant oil and frankincense, wine and oil, fine flour and wheat and cattle and sheep and horses and chariots and the body and soul of men. Nobody buys this thing, right? That whole economic system, the whole marketplace is gone in one day, destroyed, and never will rise. Over. That is going to be a secret. You know, you might think, well, we certainly trade in all of these things. We can go on Amazon, right? That might be the electronic Babylon, I don't know. And we can go and we can buy all of these things. I could go do that right now during this sermon and buy something on Amazon. And some of it might get delivered today. How crazy is that? But the bodies and souls of men, can we buy that on Amazon? Yes, we can. Can we buy these? Can we buy these today? You might not realize that slavery today is higher than at any time in the history of mankind. There's more people enslaved than there ever was in the African slave trade. The cost of slaves is lower per slave than it ever has been in the history of mankind. This is terrible. Mankind has not learned any lessons, and we all benefit from it. But it couldn't, because it takes place somewhere else within nature. Our clothing and our electronic devices and our chairs and tables and wherever else. According to antislavery.org, there are over 40 million people estimated to be sent in what is called modern slavery. 40 million. One in four of them are children, and almost three quarters of them, 71%, are women. Growing in wealth, growing in power. This great city that sits on top of literally the food chain, sits on top of this entire economic system, a global economic system where you can buy and sell anything you want as long as you follow the rules. As long as you're not following God's word in life. And you can dig into that a lot more later. If we're honest, it feels like we're living in Babylon. We're living in the suburb of Babylon. And maybe it doesn't really matter where it's centered, because it's global, right? And there's these trading places, called the City in London, it's the New York Stock Exchange, I forget the one in Berlin. But these are the heights of this whole economic system. Verse 14, it says, the fruit that your soul longs for, well, it's gone from you because of Babylon's destruction. And all the things which are rich and splendid have gone from you, and you shall find them no more at all. The merchants of these things who became rich by her will stand at a distance to feel her torment, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls. That great restaurant that we would always go and meet at, that great, you know, theater that we would watch fantastic shows, and those great arenas where we would watch the giants of our sports games clash. All of this great wealth and luxury and pleasure was gone. For in 1 hour, such great riches came to nothing. Every shipmaster, all who travel by ship, sailors, and as many as trade on the sea stood at a distance and cried out when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what is like this great city? And they threw dust on their heads and cried out, weeping and wailing and saying, alas, alas, this great city in which all who had ships on the sea became rich by her wealth. In 1 hour, she was made desolate. Not even in one day. In 1 hour, this is ended. If this is a global system, think about this for a second. You know, the description is around a city, and I'm not trying to take away from that, but if it's a global city, right, and it sits upon the circle of the earth, and it's in all of these trading areas around the world, and wherever this trading network operates, also has to be put out of business. Remember 9/11, right? When the Twin Towers were hit and all the other things that took place, and the economic systems of the world were shut down, right? The whole thing had to be shut down all the way around the world to control and minimize the risk. This is global thing. I really think it's a global thing. For all these rich and powerful merchants, they are mourning, sorry to see their source of wealth gone. And then the wealth that they have in the financial system or whatever, they're not gone too. How do you get to all of your electronic currencies when it's all wiped out? You don't have, you know, the box of gold in a deserted desert island somewhere, and even if you did, nobody cares because you can't sell gold. It just said, we cannot even sell gold, the most precious things that we have. So the whole world and all of these merchants, they mourn and cry for this great city. And then what happens? The saint says, hallelujah. There's a party about ready to take place. In chapter 20, it says, rejoice over her, O heaven, and you holy apostles and prophets, for God has avenged you out of her. It says, inside of her is the blood of the prophets and the saints and all those that he has murdered. Because then a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and threw it into the sea, saying, thus with violence the great city Babylon shall be thrown down, shall not be found anymore. The sounds of harpists, and musicians, and flautists, and trumpeters, it shall not be heard in you anymore. No more celebrations, no more parties, no more fun in that place. The light of the lamp shall not shine in you anymore, and the words of the bridegroom and the bride cannot be heard in you anymore. For your merchants were given, for your merchants were the great men of the earth, for by your sorcery all the nations were deceived. Again, it's global, right? And deceived into these trading relationships, and deceived into these partnerships, and deceived into using some of your people as slaves to make goods for the rich people of the earth. We know from history that Babylon, original Babylon, was eventually destroyed. She was occupied by the Persians. Later, Alexander the Great, I think, died in the remnants of Babylon. Overwhelmed and taken away, and you can go to that place today, and there is no party going on in Babylon. It's a desert place. There's nothing in it. And yet we see her all around us. We see her everywhere we look. We see her reforming and growing more and more powerful. I didn't have time to put together a lot of the research today for this, but there is growing evidence to show that some of the changes that were made during the COVID pandemic time frame are now being made permanent in the financial system. For example, the biggest one, if you remember, the truckers' protest in Alberta, in Canada, right? What set that down? The financial system set it down. They didn't have to go in there with riot police. I mean, they cleared it out eventually, but there wasn't big fighting in the street and, you know, the rebellion and the gunfights and all this. But all of their financial support was taken out. All of those dollars that were donated to people from around the world were frozen. Going to the bank account. And some of those financial changes have been made permanent. So, what are we to do? To go against the power of this economic system, this great city that sits above all the nations. That's the only way this city is going away. Because apparently she was beat down once before and is back and needs to be beat down again. So, we come in verse 24 to the ultimate real reason, or not real, but the most powerful reason, perhaps, of why she was destroyed. With all of her corruption, with all of her deception around the world, this great city is guilty of destroying the innocent, the beautiful saints of God, the prophets and the saints. Says, and in her was found the blood of the prophets and the saints, and of all who were slain on the earth. And it's like this secret place. If she was hiding all the bodies, those that would not follow Babylon anymore. The similarity between Babylon and Jerusalem pops out in this verse again. This evil, wicked woman, Babylon, murdered the saints of God, but she wasn't a person. Jerusalem was. In Luke chapter 13, verse 34, Jesus was mourning over the city and said, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. But you would not go in. See, your house is left you desolate, and assuredly I say to you, you shall not see me until the time comes. And you say, blessed is he who comes
another way until you see the return. Then they will say, he is blessed. Then they will finally see that he is the king. He's not one of a long line of man-made kings and rulers and powerful merchants and economic systems that trades in the lives and souls of men and destroys the saints. They will see that he is the true king. In Revelation chapter 19, it says, after all these things, after all of this destruction has come on Babylon, after this economic system, after this murderous system, after this anti-God system has been destroyed and is being destroyed, it says, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God, for true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his saints shed by her. And again they said, Alleluia, her smoke rises up forever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And then a voice came from the throne saying, Praise our God, all you his servants, and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude responding to the call for praise, and as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of the mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent. I want to be in that party. Who wants to be in that party? Amen. Where we can praise God and see his final work on the earth. Where we can see the justice that he's going to bring. And the reconciliation and the restoration and the healing to all the people and nations that were deceived. Right? And when he eliminates that corrupt system that mankind is in. I'm going to skip forward here in the interest of time. In Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11, it says, Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him is called faithful and true. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire. And on his head were many crowns. And had a name written that no one knew except himself. And he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, but you and I, clothed in fine linen, with the saints, and the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God, and his house and his goods, and his fire, and name it